How y'all looking at the end of this first preseason test?
I like where we're at. I mean, we still have ways to go, but we're making progress. I thought yesterday was a little bit better than the day before, especially when we went live, because the guys are picking up pretty quickly in our drill work. But when it's sped up because defense is out there, it's a little bit different. And so tomorrow will be a fun test to see it, because it's going to even go to another level. You got a different color jersey on top of that, you got fans in the stands. So, but I do, I like where we're at, because we got room to grow while getting better.
Nothing keeping you up at night yet, right?
No, not yet. Except my grandson when he stays with me.
Right. When you're implementing new stuff and new guys and trying to teach new things, yeah. Is part of the process having almost to break down habits of guys to do something that's maybe counter to what you want to do? Is that what you're talking about with going live and they naturally want to go into a motion that's second nature to them?
100%. Guys, you can even take a guy like tomorrow who's been used to playing a certain way for, 15, 16, however many years he's in the league, and now having to adjust to the way that we play or do things can be a little different, especially when it becomes live, because you naturally fall into your instincts and what made you have success in the past. And so for us, it's a fine line, because again, that's kind of where you're like, okay, hey, we want DeMar to fit in or somebody else to fit in to what we do, but to a certain degree, we have to adjust to make sure they're able to fit in seamlessly, knowing it's going to take some time, and also understanding that we have to make some concessions from time to time while they continue to grow within what we're trying to do as a group.
In the case of Domas, he might instinctually still want to look to pass or look to dribble handoff when you're trying to encourage him to shoot more threes. How much do you put the trust in him to, like, you have the green light, but you can still make your best decision versus, no, we really want you to take those shots?
A ton. He's been around us, and we've been around him enough. Again, it's a long season, so it's a process. And it's not going to happen overnight for the things that we want done or changed to occur. So it's going to take some time. We'll keep watching film. We'll keep drilling it. We'll keep talking about it during games, when we go live and practice, and eventually it'll all come out into the wash in terms of everybody be on the same page, doing what they're supposed to do, and hopefully we'll be clicking at a high level by then.
Is your Netflix ready to roll for tonight for Domas?
I saw episodes 1 and episodes 2 already. So I already saw them both. Very, very good. Anybody and everybody should check it out. Great series. It was really enjoyable by my part. We went down to the red carpet event down in LA.
So. It sounded like from afar that, like, offensive rebounding is something you're, like, obviously very tuned in on this year. What made you decide that needed to be such an emphasis?
Well, we started emphasizing it when we got here, and but we're trying to take it to another level this year. Because we charted it our first year, we charted it our second year, and rewarded guys when it happened, and it was a big thing of ours on that side of the ball. We made it a staple this year, and plus we changed the zones or areas where we'll send guys. But the reason why it started when I first got here, and I say this to everybody, when you lead, or quote unquote, you're the head coach, it's best when you give people ownership around you to make them feel part of the process. So I don't care if an idea comes from somebody in our video room, somebody on the coaching staff, Mel, my executive assistant, she got a great idea, hey, let's roll with it. And in this case, when it came to offense rebounding, it was Monty. He's a huge analytics guy. And he came to us during our coaches retreat in Tahoe my first year. And, the one thing I will always do if I'm not used to something, I'm going to push back, and I'm going to push back hard. And if you continue to show that you believe in what you're saying, then I'll most likely give it a go. And so he threw it out there. I said, well, it's going to kill us in transition defense. And I kept trying to find ways to fight it. And he kept sticking to his guns and saying he believed in it. So I said, okay, let's try it. And we tried it. I liked it. And so we're trying to increase it. Now, I can even take a step further back. He was the one that closed the deal on it. When I was with the Nigerian team, myself, Luke, and Jordy, we dove into it. And the New Zealand national team they have a system of crashing. And so we spent time talking to, I can't remember his name, but the head coach of the New Zealand national team and one of his assistant coaches when we were coaching tonight, so I was an assistant still at Golden State. But we spent time researching it and all that other stuff, and I kind of liked it, and I did it then because, you know, I thought we had a ton of athletes and blah, 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 blah. And so I wasn't sure if I'd carry it over here. Monty was the one that convinced me, you know what, let's really go for it and try to go for it at a high level.
It's one thing to have an idea like that. Do you feel like you have the players to really implement what it is that you need done?
This is a great question because, yes, because for the most part, and I will say this, you do need to tailor your offense and your defense to your players to a certain degree. But all these guys are high-level athletes for the most part. And at the end of the day, the separation amongst each of these guys, it's not like this. Like if it were you and me, you know, we'd be down here and they're up here. The separation is huge. But, you know, the separation amongst the athleticism and quickness is probably relatively close in most cases, in length and all that anticipation. And so you tailor your stuff around what you have, but it's about who can consistently give the effort to do it all the time, because they're human just like us. And I talked about that one guy in the YMCA pickup game being, you know, right here in your chest. And if he's there all the time, it becomes a nuisance. And pretty soon you're going to be like, I don't want to play against this guy. You know, I don't get paid. I'm not playing. It's kind of that way on our level, too. If you're attacking that glass every single possession, it gets hard. It gets hard to box out. It gets hard to deal with. It slows you down in transition going the other way. And just by effort alone, you're going to get offensive rebounds. I tell you, our best crasher last year was Trey. You know, and Trey is not the most athletic guy on the team. That doesn't mean he's a pretty good athlete. But just his sheer will and determination of trying to be consistent at it and going with force made him special in that department for us last year.
Is it a misconception when you talk about Fox and the top guys in the league, asking them to go that extra effort and be consistent with that same thing, just like you're asking everybody else? Is it a misconception that that somehow takes away from their elite talents and what they do well, and they need to save something in the tank to be able to fourth quarter for Fox or DeRozan, for example? Is that accurate?
At times it could be, you know, and a lot of it depends on what you're asking them to do and how much you're asking them to do it, you know. And I so yeah, game over. But you know, I talked about this before when I was at San Antonio. Our first sub off the bench was Malik and Biggs was Malik for David Robinson, and we put Malik on a guy like Shaq or whoever the best big was, and put Timmy on the quote-unquote weaker player. So he would be able to help a little bit more on the weak side. He wouldn't have to work. He still had to work. But, you know, guard Shaq and whoever else, it's a big difference. And so that's how you try to give those guys breaks, because you want them to bring it in a lot of different areas, especially on the scoring side of the ball. And so you try to find ways to give them breaks. And so it's like kind of the game within the game. But to a certain degree, you have to be conscious of that. You have to demand the same for everybody, but not necessarily always expect the same. And if it's close enough, then you can live with it from time to time, as long as they're not taking the play off and they're giving you it in other areas.
With that offensive rebounding, you mentioned initially being skeptical about the transition defense. Since you said you actually think it could help that, what sort of led to that change? Have you seen it actualized in practice?
Yeah, and in games, and, you know, just listening to, you know, obviously doing the research. Now, the way that New Zealand does it, we didn't you know, it was interesting how they did it, and so we didn't really adopt their style 100%. We kind of went half in, I guess, on it, and then, like I said, talking to Monty, it was a little bit more convincing, and then the next step was doing it in practice and training camp, and then seeing it on film, and you're like, hey, we're sending these guys to the glass, but because of the way we're doing it, we're still pretty good in transition defense. And you know, it's been 2 years now, going into year three, and so I'm convinced that you can attack the glass while still being good in transition defense. It just took time.
Essentially forcing other teams to focus more on defensive rebounding compared to leaking out?
That has a pretty big deal with it, because if you think about it, if I'm crashing, if Sean is going to go and I come up with one or two, any good team, you know, the teammates come, hey, you got to box out. You know, the coach doesn't even have to say anything. Next time, Sean's going to look for me, because I went last time. He's going to look for me. That's going to slow him down from getting out, because he's got to put a body on me. Now we're wrestling. Now they finally get it. Because we're wrestling, if he's doing his job, he should be inside of me. Does that make sense? And so now I have an advantage of getting back, and it shouldn't hurt you at the end of the day.
Mike, is there anything on the injury front today, and did you decide what to do with the starters tomorrow night?
I'll probably just play them in the first half, but the injuries – I don't know. Hey, y'all feel it now. See that? This is what I go through every day.
Gotcha, Malik.
Hey, that's what I say too. Gotcha, Malik. Thank you, guys.